The Supreme Court today disallowed the Binani-Ultratech combine to bid for the defaulting Binani Cement Company. It said that Ultratech, having lost out in the bid, was now reappearing with Binani as a front company. Well, this appears to be a landmark judgment. What we are asking today is, how important is this judgment in the life of the IBC? Is this a landmark one that strengthens the IBC process for the long haul? Does the judgment strengthen the convention of the bid going to the highest bidder? Does it indicate that in general, the judicial system is determined to ensure that the IBC-NCLT process doesn't get mired in judicial ambushes the way the Surfacey Act and before it the DRT Acts got ambushed? Joining me to discuss this issue is an eminent panel: Shardul Shroff, Executive Chairman of Shardul Amarchand Mangaldas; Rajendra Chitale, Advisor, Chitale Legal; Suharsh Sinha, Senior Associate, AZB and Partners; and in a bit, maybe Mr. H.P. Ranina will also be joining us. But before we go into the discussion, let us hear out our own Ashmit Kumar, our legal expert, who was at the court when the judgment was delivered. Ashmit, tell us the main points of what the judge had to say.
Right, so a big setback coming in for both Binani Industries as well as Ultratech. The Apex Court dismissing the out-of-court settlement of 7,600 crore rupees, and in doing so, clearing the air on that bigger question as far as the out-of-court settlements are concerned, as far as track two is concerned with respect to IBC, clearing the air on that. What the Apex Court clearly observed as of right now is that it believes that what cannot be achieved directly cannot be done indirectly either. That's the sum and substance of its observations. Let's keep in mind that Binani Industries had moved the Apex Court with their out-of-court settlement offer of 7,600 crore rupees, arguing that this will satisfy all the pending dues. This argument, however, failed to pass muster with the Apex Court. The Apex Court observed also heard arguments from Dalmia. Dalmia clearly saying that the sanctity of the IBC process needs to be respected, that if allowed, if this out-of-court settlement is allowed, it will open floodgates, it will reduce the number of serious bidders in resolution proceedings, it will defeat the very purpose of the IBC if the sanctity is not respected. In light of that, the Apex Court observed that this appears to be a case where what could not have been done directly is now being tried indirectly. It observed that Binani was nothing but a mere front for Ultratech, that it is a known fact that Ultratech was a bidder, it lost out, and after having lost out, it has now put up Binani as a front, as a proxy, to come back through the track two process, which is not allowed in the statute, which the Apex Court does not agree with, and hence, as a result, that relief has not been granted. It has allowed, however, Binani Industries to withdraw the applications. Binani Industries, is, in all likelihood, will now agitate this case before the NCLT, but clearly, as far as the Apex Court is concerned, shutting the doors down on out-of-court settlements on track two, as far as IBC is concerned. Back to you.
Ashmit, thank you very much for filling us in on the main points that the judge mentioned today. Once again, the broad question we are asking is this a landmark judgment in terms of preserving the sanctity of the highest bidder? Does it also prevent any out-of-court settlements? Does it reiterate the judicial system is determined not to allow the IBC process to go the way its predecessors, the Surfacey Acts and the DRT Acts, went? What can destabilize this process, and what can be done to ensure that the IBC process remains robust and helps the banking system become more efficient? Once again, let me introduce my guests, Mr. Shardul Shroff, Rajendra Chitale, Suharsh Sinha and H.P. Ranina are with us. That's absolutely legal luminaries that I have. Mr. Shroff, first to come to you, do you think that now the convention of the highest bidder is set and out-of-court settlements will be frowned upon? Is that a firm convention?
I would agree with you, Latha, because basically the Supreme Court in its deliberations today obviously gave that clear, unequivocal indication, and that has actually resulted in Binani Industries having to withdraw the matter rather than suffer a dismissal in the appeal that they had filed.
Okay. Would you say, therefore, that in future cases as well, out-of-court settlements will have a kind of a second-class treatment for all time? Is that discouraged, or is it only for this case?
No, I would say that, in fact, it requires a little longer explanation, and therefore, if you let me sort of spell it out, I'd be happy. What had happened was that you had a complete bid process resulting in a committee of creditors meeting approving a resolution plan by about 99.43% vote. You had the resolution professional filing that resolution plan before the National Company Law Tribunal. So this was a closed process as far as the bidding process goes. And secondly, Ultratech Limited was one of the bidders and it emerged as number two. So they lost in the race. Now, what was then attempted was that a combination between Binani Industries and Ultratech proposed a full settlement and consequently a withdrawal of the insolvency process. Now, this was an impermissible game for the simple reason that Binani Industries Limited as a promoter was disqualified on its own under Section 29AC. And Ultratech was also not eligible to, you know, agitate the matter because it had lost in the bid. So a combination of two persons who were otherwise not eligible to then propound a theory that they could settle the matter. And settlement means what here? Settlement meant withdrawal of the insolvency proceedings before the NCLAT. They had today, in the hearing that took place today, they had challenged the NCLAT order, which had been obtained by the Rajputana Industries, to the effect that the observations made by the Company Law Tribunal in Kolkata and the NCLAT in another matter should not come in the way or interfere with the decision making of NCLT. And therefore, Binani Industries was trying to say that no, no, that order should be set aside and we should be allowed to do things outside. And they had filed an application which indicated and reiterated the same plea that they must be allowed to withdraw the proceedings in Calcutta, and the Supreme Court has dismissed both those.
Okay. Rajendra, you watched this process, I think, from the DRT days and definitely through the Sarfesi Acts. Is the court's judgment today telling you something about the judicial system's commitment to getting the IBC process on without hitches?
Well, absolutely. I think this is a very important message that you cannot have two tracks and you need to preserve the integrity of the process through and through. And therefore, once you are into the resolution plan era, you need to go only through that process. And you cannot have an alternative mechanism to negotiate out of that process.
Okay.
So it's a very important milestone to my mind.
Well, Suharsh, what would you take away from the judgment? I think Mr. Shroff and my colleague Ashmit have detailed in as much detail as possible what they heard from the court. What will your key takeaways be as to what the judicial system is saying about the process?
Sure. No, I concur completely with Mr. Shroff. I think this is a very landmark judgment, because the IBC lays out a time-bound process for resolution of companies with very specific milestones in that time zone. There are a lot of checks and balances put in place so that there is procedural fairness for all parties involved. Moreover, the Committee of Creditors, in most cases, they come up with a very objective evaluation matrix. So even in the Binani case, the IRP, in consultation with the Committee of Creditors, had come up with a very objective and transparent evaluation matrix. And all the bids that were submitted were subjected to that matrix, and a ranking of weightage was given to each bidder. At the end of that process, if one person comes out as the winner, then that should be respected. I think there was some scope for doubt, because a few months back, the Supreme Court observed in a couple of cases, including, I believe, Lokhandwala Kataria, where Supreme Court said that an out-of-court settlement can be done, but that was under Article 142 of the Constitution, which talks about inherent powers of the Supreme Court of India. The question was whether that precedent will also be used in this case or not. I think there was general consensus that the Supreme Court, when it used 142, that should not have any precedential value when it comes to general IBC cases, because in that case, a one-on-one settlement was allowed between a particular creditor and the company. So coming back to this case, I think the Supreme Court has taken the right view, and this preserves the sanctity of the process and the integrity of the process. I believe that the H2 over here, the second bidder, later on upped the bid by a few hundred crores. But I think just because the second bidder ex post facto has raised the bid, that should not vitiate the fact that the first bidder won the process in a very fair and transparent manner.
Fair. Okay, I think we have Mr. Ranina in. Mr. Ranina, I don't know how much you could hear of Shardul Shroff's detailing of what happened today in the court, as well as my colleague Ashmit. But tell us, sir, what are your key takeaways? You have seen the judicial system's response to the previous SARFAESI and DRT, and you have seen its response to the various challenges that have come to the IBC. What would your key takeaways be in terms of the judicial system's response to the IBC process?
My key takeaway is that this is a pure interpretation of the IBC law.
Mm.
You know, different laws have different interpretations, but IBC has been given a specific interpretation by the Supreme Court in this particular case.
Okay.
So really what they've said is that once the process has started, you cannot go back on it, because otherwise, you know, people in future will lose their faith in the very process.
Okay.
Because if everybody, you know, votes a bid and then somebody goes and makes an out-of-turn settlement, then the whole process is vitiated.
Mm-hmm.
So this cannot be permitted. I think it's a correct judgment that will have a salutary effect on the insolvency process as such.
Okay. Thanks for that, gentlemen, for your initial comments. There are still, of course, issues that can kind of ambush or disturb the smooth flow of the IBC process. There have been times when the Committee of Creditors has been expanded retrospectively, and therefore a rebidding has been allowed in a specific case. Rebidding has been allowed in other cases as well. There can be the behavior of the IRP, which is different in different cases, since the institution is just evolving. What can destabilize the process, and what should we beware of? That's the question I want to ask my panel in a minute after this break.